Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Requiem by Rick Mofina, narrated by Justin Price. Time, as he grows old, teaches us all things. Aeschylus, 525 to 456 BC. Part 1. Chapter 1. Mexico City and Los Angeles. Wanda Stroud gripped the armrests as the 737 accelerated down the runway at Mexico City's International Airport. The fluttering in her stomach increased as the plane left the earth and climbed, the force pushing her into her seat. Taking deep breaths, she glanced out her window at the metropolis rolling below. The jet ascended higher and higher until finally it leveled off. Relief washed over her. Wanda might be a nervous flyer. Okay, I'm nervous about a lot of things since I lost Ed, but she would not let it prevent her from traveling, especially since it concerned her medical condition. She'd hoped the specialists in Mexico would identify what she had and treat her, unlike the doctors in California. She'd always been vigilant about her health, constantly checking for signs of illness, always anxious about whether a sore throat or runny nose was an indication of something serious, then consulting her doctor to see if she needed immediate attention. One night, a couple of months ago, Wanda had watched a TV program about a woman who had what was feared to be a new form of incurable cancer. Convinced she had the symptoms, Wanda went to her doctor, who ran a number of tests. "Your results are negative. You're fine," Dr. Singer said, smiling at her from behind her red-framed glasses. But Wanda didn't believe that she was well. She went to a second doctor, who, after testing Wanda, agreed with the first doctor's findings. There was nothing wrong with Wanda's physical health. Still, Wanda suspected the tests were incorrect and that she'd been misdiagnosed. She feared that she had the new form of incurable cancer. So, she did what she often did. She went online to do her own research. At her own expense, she arranged to go to Mexico to see doctors there, who, according to the online chat groups, were close to finding breakthrough therapies for the cancer that Wanda was convinced she had. After spending a small fortune and several weeks being examined in Mexico City, first at the renowned research center, then at the Cancer Institute, the results came back. "The cancer you are concerned about is extremely rare, and I assure you, you do not have it." Dr. Salazar of the University Center had removed his glasses and looked at her with a measure of mild, but warm, exasperation. Then he gave her the same advice that her doctors in Los Angeles had given her. "Mrs. Stroud," Dr. Salazar said, "when you return to Los Angeles, I suggest you consult your physician about relaxation techniques and refrain from online searches about your health. Your family doctor might recommend medication or therapy to help you with your anxiety and coping skills every time you think you experience a symptom." Now, as the jetliner cruised 35,000 feet over the Sonoran Desert, Wanda settled into her new seat. She was late boarding because she had requested to move from her assigned seat at the back of the plane to one closer to the front where she preferred to be. The flight was at 50% capacity, so the attendant moved her up when the plane leveled. Wanda looked at the two vacant seats in her row, then to the seats near her. Most were empty, leaving her to take stock of her life. It had been 5 years since Ed, a city bus driver, clutched his chest in the grocery store, collapsed, and died in the deli section. Some days she swore she still heard him shaving in the bathroom or making a sandwich in the kitchen. She was a 66-year-old retired librarian, a widow with no children, going home to an empty house, fearing she had an undetected illness. She swallowed and felt a tickle in her throat. What was that? Did they miss something? Maybe I should see a new specialist in L.A. She turned to the window and sighed. Maybe I should just stop acting like a foolish old woman. Wanda then considered her paperback mystery novel. She decided to take her mind off of her worries, settle in, and resume reading. That's when she looked at the lone passenger in the row in front of her, a man in his 50s with white hair and working on his laptop. It had a big screen with a large font, giving Wanda a clear and inviting view over his shoulder. Being interested in what people read, Wanda decided to take a peek. Just a little one. Was he reading a book or working on something business-related? She was curious. Okay, so I'm nosy. He had a few files open and was scrolling through them. Photos of children. His children? Grandchildren? Nieces? Nephews? Smiling, Wanda thought, whoever they were, it was nice. She often wished she'd had children, but pushed the regret away. Reaching for her book, she thought again. Wait. She glanced back at the man's screen and the little faces flowing by. The children all appeared to be young. Occasionally, he stopped the flow, which allowed Wanda to see how each child's face was framed exactly the same way. Focusing, she noticed that the bottom right corner of each photo was labeled with a multi-digit number, like a catalog or gallery of children. Is it a school album? The man's keyboard clicked as he typed, with Wanda reading his messages. Several terms and fragments of sentences emerged. Adoptee. Agreement. Transfer of rights to adoptive parents. Will obtain a decree. Facilitator. Fees. Will secure authentic-looking records and legal documents. Validating legal status as an orphan. Wanda caught her breath. Authentic-looking records? What does that mean? The man's keyboard continued clicking as he continued what appeared to be a discussion with other parties. Correct. This week, we have solid offers for number 0247 from Madrid, number 6796 from Melbourne, number 0055 from Johannesburg, number 2095 from Moscow, number 8849 from Buenos Aires, number 3716 from London, and number 9902 from Toronto. Wanda tried to make sense of what she was seeing when the man typed, "Updating price list offerings now." Price list? What could that be? His laptop flickered. The gallery of faces now showed a dollar figure in U.S. currency next to each catalog number. The numbers and young faces scrolled by. $185,000. $130,000. $155,000. Wanda's skin tingled. Something appeared to be very wrong. Illicit, even. Could that man in the seat in front of me be part of some sort of adoption ring? She cast around for an answer. Finding none, she came to accept that there had to be some rational explanation for what the man was doing. Besides, it was none of Wanda's business. She opened her book. But she couldn't read as the man continued his work. Again, Wanda was drawn to the faces of the children, their digital names and price tags. My God, what if something truly horrible is going on right in front of me, and I sat here and did nothing? How could I live with myself? What's the message about doing something if you see something? I have to do something. Okay, Wanda thought. She could get evidence, report it, and let someone expert in these things decide. She reached into her bag, got her phone, and casually swiped through it while checking to ensure no one was watching. She silenced the snapshot shutter click on her phone, muted the video recording beep, and then began taking photos of the man's screen. Carefully, she zoomed in, taking crisp pictures, photo after photo, until she'd lost count. Then she switched to video mode and recorded the man at work and the contents on his screen. She felt a tinge of embarrassment for invading his privacy. This is probably nothing, but at least I'm doing something about it. Suddenly, the man stopped typing. He turned his head slightly toward Wanda without looking at her. Oh no, did he see my reflection on his screen? He closed his laptop with a snap and then raised his seat. Wanda shoved her phone in her bag. Oh God, he knows. He knows I've been watching him. Chapter 2, Los Angeles, California. Wanda's heart beat faster. She took up her book and forced herself to carry on as if nothing had happened, but she couldn't see the words on the page. Worry clouded her concentration. She struggled to remain calm. Did the man in the row in front of her actually discover that she'd been recording the photos and conversations on his computer? No. It had to be a coincidence that he'd stopped working so abruptly. But how can I be sure of that? Wanda didn't know what to do. Should I report him? Tell someone what I saw? But I'm not sure what I saw. As minutes passed, the saliva in her mouth evaporated and her throat turned to sandpaper. Glancing up at the overhead console, she pressed the call button. A moment later, an attendant appeared at Wanda's row. Yes, the attendant said. Wanda glanced ahead. She didn't know what to do. The man was reading a magazine, leaving her paralyzed with indecision. May I help you? The attendant asked. Could I please have some water? Certainly. The attendant returned with a glass of water. Sipping it refreshed Wanda, and she continued to feign reading while debating what to do. What if she was completely wrong about what she'd seen? What if she set something in motion that couldn't be reversed by making an allegation that proved to be false, but which had grown out of control? What if she started something that could ruin this man's life? I'm getting carried away. This is silly. I have got to get a grip. Wanda turned to her window, searched the clouds, and tried to relax, losing track of time. Before she knew it, the public address system was announcing their descent into Los Angeles. After a bumpy landing, the plane came to a stop at the gate. Passengers unbuckled their seatbelts, stood, made phone calls, stretched, and collected their belongings. Wanda remained in her seat, watching the man. He slid his computer into its bag then, and stood with his back half turned to her. He reached up across the aisle, opened the overhead bin, and withdrew his black carry-on bag. Making a quick estimation, she thought him fairly good-looking. Clean cut. He wore jeans and a white shirt under a navy jacket. Placing the strap of his computer bag on his shoulder and shifting it to his side, he set his larger piece of luggage on the floor. Staying in the empty row across the aisle, he made eye contact with Wanda when she stood. Allow me. Smiling, the man gestured to the bin above her, clicked the latch, and opened the door. I'll get your bag for you. Wanda smiled back. Thank you, but no, it's checked. Wanting him to precede her because she was undecided about what, if anything, she was going to do, she nodded to the aisle. He didn't move. After you, he said. You go, please. You have more to carry. No, he gestured for her to move forward. Please, go ahead. Someone had cleared his throat. Wanda and the man turned to the unsmiling passengers waiting in line behind them. People wanted to get off the plane. Wanda conceded and went first. The man followed her, and they joined the others ahead of them, shuffling out of the plane and then along the jetway. They disembarked at Terminal B, the Tom Bradley International Terminal, and followed the signs guiding them to U.S. Customs and baggage claim. On the escalator descending to the lower level, Wanda passed under the massive U.S. flag and sign that greeted her with the words, Welcome to the United States. While disappointed with the outcome of her Mexico trip, it was good to be back in the country, Wanda thought. She moved along in the river of arriving passengers to the customs and border protection area and held a measure of relief because she'd lost sight of the man on the plane. Good. She didn't want to think about him right now. She was tired. She just wanted to get her bag, hop into a cab, and get home. She needed a good night's sleep in her own bed. Then, if she still wanted to report what she'd seen on the plane, well, I'll think about it later. Walking through the terminal, unaware that the man was walking directly behind her, Wanda's thoughts shifted. She hadn't been confident enough in her technical skills to use the mobile passport process on her phone, so she'd completed the blue customs declaration form on the plane. Withdrawing it now from her bag, along with her passport and airline ticket, She joined the long queue, zigzagging toward the line of desks and CBP agents. For the next 15 minutes, Wanda inched her way through the maze of posts and belts, and then caught her breath.
Oh no.
Coming to a turn, she suddenly found herself next to the man on the plane. There were a few other people, including a couple with two small children, separating them. But the configuration of the turn in the queue had put Wanda and the man nearly shoulder to shoulder, making it impossible for them not to notice each other. Hello again, he said, smiling. Hello, Wanda said. Quite an ordeal, he said, indicating the lines of people waiting to get to the desks and go through customs. Sometimes this process can take a couple of hours. Other times you breeze through. Wanda smiled and nodded, sensing that he wanted to talk, something she was reluctant to do, but their line was not moving. She was trapped. You sat behind me on the flight, didn't you? He said. Chapter 3, Los Angeles, California. The man waited for Wanda to reply. She hesitated for an awkward moment before smiling politely. Yes, she said. I did. I was behind you. He nodded, then said, Mexico City's beautiful, isn't it? Yes, it is. I was there on business. How about you? Wanda hesitated, glancing at the others in line. One man was reading a book, 100 Years of Solitude. Using his declaration form and ticket as a bookmark. An older couple was talking softly in Spanish while tapping a map, and a young mother and father had lowered themselves to tend to their two toddlers, who seemed bored and on the brink of tantrums. No one was paying attention to Wanda and the man. Vacation, she lied, hoping the line would move. The man smiled, nodding. Vacation, he repeated. What's your line of work, if I may ask?
I'm actually retired. I was a librarian.
Librarian? His eyebrows climbed. I love libraries. I do a lot of research there. I write screenplays.
Screenplays? For movies?
He'd awakened Wanda's interest, suddenly casting her anxiety in a positive light. Yes, in fact, that's why I was in Mexico City. Doing research for an upcoming project, a script for a major movie, a global crime thriller.
Well, that sounds interesting.
Brad Pitt and Meryl Streep have signed on.
How exciting. I adore Meryl Streep.
That could all change, of course. It's the nature of the business. But the producers want, actually, they demand that the script ring as true as possible. That's why I was in Mexico. To research organized crime stuff.
That's so interesting.
He nodded while eyeing her closely. Then he lowered his voice and said, I wanted you to know, in case you glimpsed my research while I was working on the plane. I wouldn't want you to get the wrong impression. He laughed softly.
Oh, no. Well, Wanda's cheeks reddened. Well, no. You have a very interesting job, that's for sure.
It can be, he said. It can also be extremely challenging. A gap emerged in the line. Wanda gave the man a little wave before moving farther ahead, bringing their conversation to an end. 20 minutes later, Wanda cleared customs. She continued through the terminal toward the baggage claim area. Her unease about the man and what she'd seen on his laptop had dissipated.
Writing a screenplay. Researching a thriller movie. It all made sense.
She was glad she had never reported him or made a scene.
He seems like a nice guy, and I would have looked like a fool.
She shook her head. She had other things to deal with, like her medical situation. While walking, she reached into her bag for her phone and texted her friend Colleen.
Hey, Col, just landed. Coffee tomorrow at our spot? One? Okay?
Wanda would tell Colleen what the doctors in Mexico had said. Wanda felt that she needed to see another doctor in L.A. Colleen was her best friend, a sympathetic listener who understood everything she was going through ever since she'd lost Ed. She always gave her good advice.
even though I don't always take it.
Waiting for Colleen's response, Wanda glanced around and saw the screenwriter again. He was near, but across the floor and a little behind her as they continued walking. He was on his phone. Wanda heard only bits of his conversation. He was talking in Spanish. She didn't understand what he was saying. He shot her a glance before turning away. Working for Meryl Streep and Brad Pitt has to be stressful, she thought. They arrived in the baggage claim area, and Wanda found the carousel for their flight. The conveyor system was humming. A few bags had emerged. While waiting with other passengers, Wanda's phone chimed with a notification. Colleen had responded.
Yes, to coffee tomorrow. Meet you there at 1. How did it go in Mexico?
A parade of bags started on the carousel. Wanda glanced at it, watching for hers as she typed a response.
Not so good. Tell you about it tomorrow. Okay. Good flight?
Wanda watched for her bag and then went back to her phone.
A weird thing happened on the plane. Tell you tomorrow. Ah, don't leave me hanging.
People had started collecting their bags when Wanda's large bag with the colorful flowered pattern appeared.
Gotta go. Sorry. You're so mean. See you tomorrow.
Wanda put her phone away and reached for her big bag, struggling to heft it from the conveyor, when the screenwriter materialized and grasped it.
I've got this for you, he grunted.
Oh, thank you.
No problem.
Setting it down, he took up her ID tag and studied her address.
Wanda, he smiled. I see you live in Downey.
Yes.
You won't believe it, but I live in Pico Rivera, nearby.
Really?
Really. What are the odds?
It's a small world, for sure.
She smiled and took up her bag.
Thanks again. Good luck with your script.
She turned to start for the exit.
Wanda, wait, he said. The studio has sent the car for me. I can give you a lift home. No charge. It's on the way.
Wanda swallowed. Caught off guard by his generosity, she had to think fast.
Thank you very much, but I don't want you to go to the trouble.
It's no trouble. It's right on my way.
No, really. Thank you. It's very kind of you, but I've got a friend waiting, she lied. Thank you.
Wanda started for the exit when she heard his phone ring. Walking away, she heard him drop his voice and start a conversation in Spanish, possibly hearing the word flores, which she knew meant flowers. Outside, when Wanda made her way to the taxi pickup area, she sighed at yet another long line. Waiting her turn to be assigned a cab, she felt a bit ashamed.
Was I rude? Too quick to refuse the screenwriter's kind offer?
It could have been fun to ride in a studio car. Maybe pick up some Hollywood gossip on what the stars are really like. Besides, if she had this new cancer, despite what the doctors told her, shouldn't she live life to the fullest?
Wanda.
Pulled from her thoughts, she looked just across the traffic lanes to a shiny, dark blue sedan that had stopped and was parked in a tow-away zone. The screenwriter had gotten out of the back seat and was approaching her.
What happened? Did your friend stand you up?
Her face reddened again as he stood near her.
Yes, I'm afraid she had to cancel. Car trouble.
My offer is still good. Come with me.
Wanda saw the car's trunk pop open and the driver get out.
I don't want to trouble you.
Don't be silly.
You're sure it's no trouble?
None at all. We're going your way.
All right, then. Thank you.
You know, he said, taking her bag and leading her to the car. This is the same car Streep used, and she left her sunglasses.
Really?
Want a souvenir?
The driver nodded to Wanda, placed her bag in the trunk, and closed the lid. She got in the back beside the screenwriter and buckled her belt.
Thank you again, she said. You really didn't have to do this.
I know, he said, checking his phone. But I wanted to.
As they pulled away and navigated from LAX toward the freeway, Wanda shivered with anticipation.
This will be fun. I'm glad I did this.
At that moment, as the car gathered speed. All of the door locks snapped. Chapter 4. Downey, California. The next afternoon, Colleen Eden arrived at the coffee shop 10 minutes early and got a table by the window. She held off ordering, preferring to wait until Wanda arrived. Colleen wanted to hear about the trip to Mexico. Wanda was persevering, she thought, but Ed's death had changed her. It was as if she were a broken china cup that had been reassembled. The fracture lines were there, behind her smile, behind her eyes, prompting her to do impulsive things, like travel to Mexico. Apart from grieving the death of her husband, Wanda had begun obsessing about her health, often imagining she had a range of serious medical conditions. Colleen had, long ago, gently suggested Wanda see a therapist about her unfounded health fears, but nothing came of it. The best Colleen could do was be her friend. "Hi, can I get you something?" A man in his 20s, with a beard, ponytail, apron, and rolled-up sleeves, asked. "Thanks, but I'll wait till my friend gets here." "Sure thing." Colleen looked out the window, searching the sidewalk. Then she checked the time on her phone. 1:19. Wanda's late. That's not like her. She's punctual and conscientious. No messages, nothing. Biting her lip, Colleen sent her a text. "I'm here at our favorite table. What's up?" Waiting for a response, Colleen thought back to when they met years ago at a CLA conference. At the time, Colleen was a librarian in Whittier and Wanda a librarian here in Downey, after working a short time in the records department for the Downey police. Colleen and Wanda had been pals a long time and had been through a lot together. Wanda had helped her survive her divorce, but Colleen refused to dwell on the wound left by her adulterous ex. She glanced at her phone. My goodness. It was now 1:35. And not a word from Wanda. This isn't like her. Colleen called her, but it went to Wanda's voicemail. She left a message. Then Colleen looked up and down the street, thinking there had to be a simple explanation for why Wanda hadn't shown up yet. Colleen waited and waited, but after nearly an hour, she'd become antsy. What's keeping her? Wanda's house wasn't far. She texted her again, this time to say she was coming over. To be safe before leaving, she called her again. Again it went to voicemail. Colleen sent a new message saying she was on her way. She left the coffee shop, got into her car, and drove. Stopped at a red light, Colleen looked at her phone in her open bag on the passenger seat. Not a word from Wanda. Colleen couldn't remember a time when she'd been this late, or missed one of their dates. What could be keeping her? It didn't take long before she turned onto De Palma. After a few blocks, she stopped in front of Wanda's neat-as-a-pin yellow stucco bungalow with the palms in the front yard. Wanda's Ford Fusion was in the carport. Colleen rang the bell and listened. Expecting to hear movement, Colleen heard nothing. She pressed the doorbell a second time. The house was silent. She knocked, hard. Nothing. Concern pinging at her, she walked around the house to the rear and knocked on the patio doors. No response. Shielding her eyes, Colleen drew her face to the glass. Wanda? Wanda, it's Colleen. Silence. She's not home. Catching her breath, Colleen turned to see a man watching from the fence dividing the yards. Then she sighed. It was Wanda's neighbor, Lynn Peterson, the retired accountant and Navy veteran in his backyard, tending to his thriving lemon trees. Hi, Lynn.
Hi, Colleen.
Yeah, Wanda's not home.
Not home, but she got into LAX yesterday. She was texting me. We had a date for coffee over an hour ago, and she didn't show up. That's why I'm here.
Odd. Peterson scratched his head.
I have her mail on my kitchen counter. She would have collected it by now. No lights came on last night. There's no sign of her.
Worry coiled up Colleen's spine.
I don't like this, Lynn. I know where she hides her spare key. I'll get it, but will you come inside with me to check on her?
You want to go inside?
Yes. She could have been jet-lagged, fallen asleep, fell in the tub, or took too much medication. Who knows?
Sure. I'll be right there.
Colleen got the key from under the egg-shaped rock in the flower bed near the window of the garden shed. Wanda knew where Colleen kept her key, too. They had made a promise to look out for each other. Len showed up with a Louisville slugger in his hand. Colleen looked at the bat, then at Len.
In case there's trouble, he said, shrugging. You never know.
They entered from the side door. The air was a bit stale, with a fragrant hint of cleaner as they entered the kitchen. With its white cabinets and ivory backsplash, it was spotless, immaculate. Colleen called to her friend.
Wanda? It's Colleen and Lynn. Are you all right, honey?
They heard nothing. Lynn opened the fridge. It was bare, save for condiments and jars of olives and pickles. Colleen looked in the trash. It was empty.
Wanda!
The small dining room with its oak table and chairs was empty. The living room was empty. The bed was made in Wanda's bedroom. It was empty. Her other bedrooms were empty. So were the bathrooms. No signs of luggage, unpacking, or laundry. The house held an eerie stillness.
I've got a very bad feeling, Colleen said.
Chapter 5. Manhattan, New York City. This could cost me my job, FBI Special Agent Jill McDade said. Ray Wyatt nodded. From their table in Bryant Park, McDade and Wyatt, a reporter for True Signal News, watched the children laughing on the carousel and the jugglers nearby. With its promenades bordering the lush green lawn, the fountain, the gardens, the vendors, and cafe-like tables under the shade trees, the park was an oasis in the midtown canyon of towering glass and steel between 41st and 42nd streets. McDade liked the calm and peace of Bryant Park and thought it best to meet there. Her hands rested on her tablet. We've been through a lot together, Ray.
We have, and I trust you.
Wyatt nodded.
I'm going to show this to you because of what's at stake for you, and because I need you to see it, to help the investigation.
Understood. She tapped on her tablet, turned it to Wyatt, presenting him with a head-and-shoulder color photo of a boy. As Wyatt stared at the image, the carousel music, the laughter, and traffic sounds faded. The boy looked lean, bordering on gaunt, offering a slight, nervous smile that pierced Wyatt, then ripped him open. Riveted to the image of the boy in the photo, a tsunami of emotions, memories, love, and agony overcame Wyatt, flooding him with hope. Tears came to his eyes. At the same time, he was terrified.
I think, this is Danny, Wyatt said.
I think so, too. I needed your help identifying this boy.
He's alive?
Where?
How did you get this?
Give me your word this stays confidential.
Jill, this could be my son.
I need your word, Ray.
You said you trust me.
Yes.
Then trust me to do the right thing.
Ray, this must stay with us. We've only just started the investigation.
It had been a few months since the Hydra case exploded in Vermont. The story had long disappeared from the headlines. Last night, McDade had come out to Queens to see Wyatt, telling him that maybe he was right to believe his son Danny was alive after all this time. But she was unable to say more. Wyatt had demanded to know if she was keeping information from him, until finally McDade asked him to meet her the next day in Bryant Park. Now, here they were. After showing him the photo, McDade started elaborating, pulling him back through the years and the pain. Danny was 3 when he was killed in a hotel fire in Banff, Alberta, Canada, while Wyatt and his wife, Lisa, were there on vacation. Canadian authorities told them how Danny had died with others in the blaze
and that they'd been unable to find Danny's remains. Nothing, not even DNA, because Danny had been incinerated due to the intensity of the inferno.
Ray and Lisa never forgave themselves. Grappling with their guilt and grief, they'd refused to accept that Danny was dead. Ray had consulted experts who believed Danny's teeth should have survived, thereby enabling DNA testing and proof. Without proof that Danny was dead, Wyatt and Lisa never gave up believing he was alive. As time passed, Wyatt did all he could to search for a resolution. He pushed sources and reached out to people who were in Banff at the time of the fire. Lisa went into therapy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.